We in the great Garden State.
See how this makes me happy.
This makes you happy?
Makes me happy.
Is this a pregame song for you?
What? Dirt?
Yeah.
For sure. It's all dirt.
How hype you get when you listen to this one? These ain't no gas juice.
That day they shot you, I stayed on the mongoose. You could not come back around me, you turned your back on me, I cannot forget. Napoleon was lying, they said that they caught you, but nigga, they made you admit. Your name was fine, you put in that work, they took your stake, you a bitch. Fuck my ass, they be on my dick, they all be mad, we rich.
Under 25, living like a ball, riding around with a chauffeur.
You said under 25, riding around with a chauffeur. Niggas lying, I'm stealing.
Off-season.
All men are created equal. Some just work harder during the off season.
Let's work.
But you already know, bing bong boom, it's Mr. Worldwide. When I step in the room, I'm a hustler, baby.
You already know, it's your boy Big 38. Yo.
Yes, sir. It's Coach Carey, aka MC4, aka Mr. Dap himself up.
Oh, I like that. I like that.
Yeah.
You can do it. You want to do it with us? Oh, yeah, just Mr. Dap yourself up.
Okay, I like
that. Yeah, there we go. There we go.
Cool, we there.
And we got a Jersey legend.
Legend, special guest.
Oh, special guest.
GOAT coach.
GOAT coach. On the rise, coach.
On the rise.
You can say that. You can say
on
that.
On the low.
Say that one.
Mr. Do it himself.
Yeah, get it done.
You know what I'm saying? Mr. Get it done. Hey, Brandon, Napoleon. Hey, appreciate you coming on.
First coach, right? First college coach. Respectfully. Make it a trend.
Yeah,
we trying to make it a trend. I got a list. You were on the list. I told him that. I was like, you got to get Napoleon on here.
I'm like,
because he had the relationship.
And it's easy, you know, one phone call away.
That's it. And he
big bro right here, you know what I'm saying?
I don't know.
I remember going back in high school, going to y'all games. I think I was in eighth grade when y'all was really like that.
St. Peter's Prep.
Yeah, St. Peter's. Y'all was really like that. You had Savon, shoot. Minka wasn't even there yet.
Sean Royster.
Man, that team was crazy.
I know Keith from Rutgers. Woo! Lump is a good dude. He's a cop now.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
That's a large cop. Yo, you see him walking down the street. Whoa!
Ballhead cop.
He said ballhead.
Shout out to Lump, man.
Lump, good people, man. I remember going to those games. I'm like, I'm coming to St. Peter's. And then I thought about it. I was like, ain't no way I'm taking a train all every day.
Hey, you did it?
I did it every day. Every day for 4 years.
That's a grind.
So what time did you have to get up to catch the train?
I used to get up at 5 a.m. So that's why coaching now is easy. I used to get up to do that for 4 years.
You were a morning person by default at
that
this point.
That was every single day.
Every single day. And I'm getting home at 8:39 at night every day.
Dang.
So I was living in college before college was even a note in my head.
People don't even know the struggle of going to some of those prep schools or getting to transportation and all that stuff, man.
That's the thing, because in Jersey, these prep schools, I mean, there's a lot of talent in our area. Like Central Jersey, you go a little south, they got talent.
For sure.
But, all, you know, growing up, there was no South Jersey dog, you know, prep schools.
Right.
It was St. Peter's Prep, Bosco, Bergen Catholic.
Rammus came on late.
When Jabril went there, and then now DePaul's kind of working their way up to get to that level. But again, all North Jersey.
Right.
Now you got, I mean, Red Bank Catholic, they're starting on the rise to get Augustine. The South. Yup. And then you got like St. Joe's Hamilton. Like
I never heard of Donovan Catholic until last year.
Really?
Yeah.
I think it's a relatively newer school. It used to be called Monsignor Donovan.
Okay, got you.
So now it's a little change now.
Cerebral high school guru right there. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I'm about to say exactly.
He knows everything about.
New Jersey high school football.
He knows everything about New Jersey. Like you ask Carey, he knows somebody who knows that person. I'm like,
yeah.
Oh, like,
I try. I mean, I try.
Well connected.
He's the big shot right here.
No. I'm in the presence of two goats right now. I'm just a guy here.
I am not a goat.
The pod with the guys. That's all me.
He is him.
No, I'm seeing that now. I'm seeing that, lo and behold, that he is him.
Not me. I'm just here.
But let's dive right into
it. Let's dive into you, though.
Yo, break it down for us
who you are as a person growing up as a young kid from Rahway, going to St. Peter's, all that. Break it down for the people. Tell them who you are. Give them a little background about yourself.
You already know I'm Coach Napoleon, Brand Napoleon. But at the end of the day, I'm just a grinder. You know, mm-hmm. I've been that way mm-hmm. since Rahway and Pittman,
growing up. And then obviously, it's almost like going into college recruiting. You know, I was good at middle school. So it was
for Bergen Catholic. Those guys would come out to my games and watch me. I took a day of a life of a freshman at Bergen Catholic. I didn't really like it.
Okay.
And I went to St. Peter's Prep. And that's when, you know, I met my guy right here. Miles.
Yeah.
Going through that, 4 years of that, is just you see everybody. You see Will the Thrill Hill. He's a Jersey legend. You see Savon doing it. You mm-hmm. see Sheldon doing it. It just makes you want to grind to do that and be the best that you can be as well. So at the end of the day, when it all came to said and done, I ended up being a 3-star, All-American. I played with Todd Gurley in All-American game. We was the first to play in the Semper Fi game.
Wow.
So it was a blessing. Ended up committing to North. No one knows it. A lot of people don't know this. I committed to North Carolina. Decommitted and went to West Virginia.
Wow.
West Virginia.
I did not know that.
I also did not know that.
I was committed to North Carolina. And West Virginia was going through a coaching change.
Mm-hmm.
Bill Stewart didn't get the job. They gave it to Dana Holgorsen. Holgorsen flew out to my mom's job, offered me.
Wow.
I took my official. I committed on my official on Father's Day.
I know that West Virginia lifestyle. I heard a little bit about West Virginia.
If you make it out of West Virginia, you made it out of
true party school.
Hey, true party school.
I didn't make it out. That was, I didn't get a chance to make it out. But, you know, I say that to say I went to West Virginia. It was a lot. You know, mm-hmm. partying, going from a private school, all boys, and it was strict to the number one party school in the country. We just beat Clemson the year before that, 77-33. It was wild.
Yeah.
You know, I got a chance. I grounded myself, redshirted, because I needed, you know how they go. You gotta get your body right. I played my redshirt freshman year, tore my knee my redshirt sophomore year, and decided to transfer. So I went to Northern Iowa. I can say this, I'll be open. You know, I got a little bit of trouble, got kicked out of school. Mm-hmm. Went to Georgetown, NAI in Kentucky. Went and had a little bit of trials, tribulations there as well. Decided to leave and ended my career at Kansas Wesleyan. But I get into coaching just to help kids out there like me. You know, every coach along my way gave me a chance. I went to four different schools and never had to pay for school. And I'm going to write a
that's
book.
A about that. Yeah, that's a blessing.
I'm going to write a book about that because not everybody gets that chance.
Not everybody gets that many chances.
That many chances. So I want to be that coach that sees the light in the younger man and say, he's not a bad kid, he's had a bad guidance. Or something doesn't click with him and is messing him up.
Absolutely.
At the end of the day, I want to be that guy, give him a chance, teach him what I know. Obviously, I went to four different schools under four, probably 10 different position coaches. So I know a lot of... I know a lot, you know, and mm-hmm. I want to be able to give that back and then keep growing with the profession just to be the best coach I can be and have the same mindset that I had as a player and take that into coaching, you know.
So in high school, you played a little quarterback too, right?
What? You can sling that thing?
Come on, man. That's
I played a little quarterback.
That's all I played in high school, so that's why I went with West Virginia.
I was a few while I was playing corner, but, you know.
You was a'ight.
I would have dotted you.
Now, is this what kind of, is this a power? Were you handing the ball off? Were you running the ball?
Savon, he wasn't throwing it.
He wasn't handing the ball to the number one player in the state.
Number two player in the country. I'm just sitting there handing the ball off. We running triple option.
I can make this.
Just think about it. We was in a shotgun. It was Sheldon Royster next to me and Savon Huggins. I had number two running back in the country, and I had like number eight athlete. So
they made it nice and easy.
Yeah, they made it easy for me to just.
You want to read? I got you.
Yeah, we reading and we just going. But when I did throw it, it was a touchdown because no one expected me to throw the ball.
Of course.
It was cool.
Respectfully.
I still would have dotted you, though, but respectfully.
It's nice not – that's going – he's saying that on that side, not this side.
I would have ran you over.
No, that's not true. That's definitely not true.
No, that's
I would because I would have hit the ankles and you would have just fell right down.
I ain't going to lie. He was a great tackler.
No, yeah.
He was a great tackler.
Fun fact, you probably didn't know this about me. I was a quarterback my whole life.
See?
I ain't played defense in my senior year.
Yeah, I don't know why they want to switch the quarterbacks to defense. Maybe because we have the most knowledge. I don't know.
I was definitely the quarterback.
He got benched because his arm sucked.
Definitely not. I was 5-1. I was 5-1.
He hates
what
people say. It. He hates
my nickname in high school was Noodle.
Noodle, because his arm was a noodle.
Now, because some guy online that probably sits in his basement and doesn't really know much decided to call me Noodle Arm. And in my freshman year, some of my friends called me. I mean, the guy. I feel bad for that guy, though.
You feel bad for him?
Yeah, because look at me now. I'm doing good. Doing great. I'm back giving back to the same school that I played at. I won 3 state championships at.
And now,
no, I did not lose a game my senior year. We had the best defense like in the state.
Best defense.
I mean, I can't complain. I'm
already in college, buddy. That guy.
So,
listen, yeah, you already.
We would have smoked St. Peter's your senior year. I mean,
and you know that
his senior year and your senior year. Your senior, not your junior year.
We were the number one public school in the state that year.
We would have smoked y'all. Your senior year. Your senior year wasn't like that. It wasn't like that, but y'all wasn't.
What?
Y'all was not messed. Come on, that's too different.
I'm just letting you know, like,
y'all had. We had what?
We had me.
Yeah, now G Glass at wide receiver. He would have got strapped.
By who, you?
Real track star. He should have stayed on the track. No kizzy.
You think you would have been able to run with that?
Yes.
He was a sophomore that year, too.
No, yes. He was. Yeah, Zach, you would have got.
You playing cover two over top. You ain't doing that. I was a safety. I played safety. I ain't corner.
I was a linebacker at 160 pounds soaking
our
wet.
Our defense was like that.
You see what he said? I was a linebacker. Like, it would have been good for you.
Matter.
It would have been good. If I would have broke through and saw you 1-on-1, that was
Coach Hanson.
Coach Hanson won't let that happen, huh? Coach Hanson won't let that happen. Yeah, like we lost it. We did lose Montclair. We lost Montclair.
Is that what?
Oh, we beat Montclair.
Herbert was like that.
Oh,
he was probably one of the most electric players
to ever play in Jersey.
Who's that?
Khalif Herbert.
Oh my God.
Went to Temple.
Yep.
That was a shootout. He had 7 touchdowns. I had 6 touchdowns. And we lost.
That man had over 40 touchdowns that year.
Yeah, he was a Gatorade player of the year.
It was crazy.
So that's what I'm saying. We lost to them because of him. But if we would have played him,
I would have had at least 5.
No dice.
I'm just saying. I'm not asking. I
know you're still in shape, but I'm getting back. We can put on the pads and see how that
pick a hole goes.
You have to pay me to do it.
I like that.
That's that league shit. That's that league.
I don't play football for free no more.
I try to get him to race somebody. He's like, you paying? I said,
it's a money maker right there.
Yeah, you can't mess with that.
You probably get fined for that one.
Yeah, like, what's up?
Oh, you lose race on the street.
Everything.
Yeah, you lose race on the street.
For everything.
So, after college, what was kind of the stepping stones that you took to kind of get into your profession after that?
After college, you know, everybody has a shot. I did the CFL thing. We did the AFL thing with the Albany Empire and the Cedar Rapids River Kings. And I was like, the XFL was the last cut. I was like, I'm not going to not make a team or get cut no more. And like I said, I always wanted to be a coach from when I went to West Virginia and they switched my position. I'm like, I would never do this to a kid. You know, recruiting, I'm always keeping real with them.
Absolutely.
So from West Virginia, I knew after I'm done with football, I'm getting into coaching. So I got a little bit of money from selling life insurance. You know, I did that for like four or five months, emailed around and got a job at Susquehanna University. But just that drive to help kids out. Like, I want to help the kids out. It's not really about me. I already did the thing, but I want other people to experience. I want to
give back.
Do the damn thing. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. You get a chance to do it, and now I'm just fulfilling it to them. Like, almost the same thing that I hope that you'll do. When you're done playing football, you have so much knowledge from being years in the league. You come back, you might go to Saver High School and be the AD, just chilling.
Yep.
You know what I mean? But you're giving back to your community. You're giving back to the kids that look up to you. Like, yeah.
That's the biggest thing with life. Like, you can't get all this knowledge and then die with the knowledge.
Exactly.
Then you did a disservice to yourself and the people after you.
Exactly.
Like, there's no reason why that's the most humbling thing. When you can give back and then that 1-2 people get that information that you drop, and you're like, then he really got what I said, and he's hitting you up like, yo, you changed my life. Those are the moments that you remember
most. I'm telling you, bro, like, just teaching a kid to take, like, me going to the field and catching a pick, okay, cool. Like, yeah, that's live. I did that. But me teaching it, going through Indy, and then now the kid drives back and cover two, breaks on the ball, catch a pick. That's a better feeling.
Rewarding.
Like, it's like, I taught him that, and he's actually listening, and that is now he's rewarded, and now he's happy.
Yeah. You know
what I mean? Like, that feeling's way more. Like, I got goosebumps
when
thinking about
clicks,
it.
When it clicks for somebody, like, same here, like, when it clicks for somebody.
That must be a coaching thing.
It's a coaching thing.
It's got to be. I mean, you said you were going to coach with me when you're done.
Yeah, if you're a head coach, I'll be the DC, but other than that, I'm not coaching. I would never coach college football. Y'all got no time off. Like, I feel like when my coaches, we weren't with our coaches, they on the road traveling here. I'm like, bro, ain't no way you got to. Then you got some parents that you got to deal with. I ain't with none of that. Y'all talk about that coaching stuff real quick. I want to hear some.
Yeah, so like, gym. You know, in the last couple years, how long you been coaching? This is going on what, like year four?
Year four.
And you've kind of had to, like, you moved around. I mean, we were kind of talking about it. We hit it a little out there. You know, in coaching, the turnover is crazy, right? Because you can go, like, either staff gets fired and you got to go, or you find another job. You know, you've been at a bunch of places. So kind of explain that transition from place to place and like how you move. Because I know you got family at home. Yep. You got a young son now. Yep. Like, how does that affect decision making? Because, you know, a lot of times coaches can't do that. You know, that's why, you know, there's 100 million high school coaches in the world that would love to coach college and they can't because of the time commitment, you know, family time and stuff like that. So kind of dive into how that, like, the family life and going from job to job affects you.
Well, now it affects me with the little baby, of course. Mm-hmm. I would say this. When I was in Susquehanna, it really didn't affect me. I had a girlfriend, and I'm like, I'm going to do what I want to do. Took the girlfriend that I had down in Midwestern State in Texas, and that's when the decision making started, because that's when my son was conceived, you know, in Texas. And I was a GA, not making a lot of money. So, like you said, decision making. So I'm like, all right, I'm not on insurance here. I'm a GA.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I have a kid on the way. We're about to have some bills. So that's why some people don't know. I left the places when I left. I was there for 2 months. 1 month, it was for my family. Like, I left Midwestern State because I had a son on the way.
Yeah.
So I took a full-time job back at PA, and my wife is from PA. So it was always a family decision. It wasn't like, oh, the coaching average is up and then leaving again.
Yeah.
I left for my family, respectfully.
Mm-hmm.
If my son wasn't conceived, I would have stayed at Midwestern State.
Yeah.
So when I got to Geneva, it was a D3. I was a co-defensive coordinator. I was a defensive back coach. It was a D3. It was cool, but I know my potential was probably a little bit higher. So I left and went to Cookstown.
Mm.
And it was a pay cut, but I was an hour away from my family and 30 minutes away from my wife's family.
Yeah.
And PA still.
And the Cookstown's a fire piece.
Having a young son at that time and being able to have family. So when you got to go and your wife needs help, it's like, having that.
Exactly.
You sacrificed that for the family.
Yeah, I sacrificed the money for help. My wife needed help while I'm in season.
Right.
And Cookstown's like one of the best D2s in the country. Yep. So it all matched. So I went there. But then obviously another opportunity comes for me to be a GA. It was Murray State offered me a GA job in Buffalo. So I had a chance to either go to Kentucky, which is really far in the country. I already had some problems in Kentucky.
Mm-hmm.
Or go to Buffalo and learn under Coach Maurice Lewis, who just came from Texas A&M, the Dallas Cowboys and things like that. It was a no-brainer. I'm going to
no-brainer.
You know what I mean? Like, it's a no-brainer. And it's a little bit of a more pay raise. So every move I made was either for my profession and family. It was profession and family.
Absolutely.
Like, so, and I know what you mean. Like, high school coaches sometimes can't do that because, you know, either they're older in the game or they're scared to take that leap of faith. Like, I took the leap of faith and, you know, my first job, I was making $7,000 a year. Like,
bet on you.
Bet on me. You know what I mean? So,
that's tough. I don't understand. Like, you want to... People always talk about coaches don't do this, coaches don't do that, but then they get paid $7,000 a year. How do you even make ends meet?
Your mom was $7,500 when I was at ASA.
Like, that's
the year.
Like, the people who are
$250 every 2 weeks.
The people who are supposed to be pouring into the people who are supposed to be pouring into the young men and the young athletes get paying $7,000 a year, and you expect the work to be the best.
Full time. That's full time. Yeah. So you're not, like, they say you get paid part-time, but there ain't nothing part-time about coaching.
No. And coaching is, like, full-time.
And that was part of the reason that I had to step away from Kane is that I didn't have, like, I got a lot going on here, and I wasn't able to give 110% back there. And that would be a disservice to the team as well as the coaching staff, and I didn't want to do that.
Is there a coaching association? Like,
AFC.
They don't help y'all they don't have, like, a minimum that part-time coach.
It's not a union.
Okay.
So we don't have, like, a union. Like, you guys got the NFLPA.
Yeah.
We don't got that.
You don't got a coach. Yeah, we don't got a coach.
There's a coaching, like the AFC is a coaching association, but they don't help. Like, that's not something that they do.
They do? Okay.
Yeah.
Because that's just mind-boggling.
Yeah, absolutely. It was mind-boggling to me.
Like, it's over 40 hours a week for $7,000 a year.
Over 40. It was like
They just calculate the times you're on the field, and they don't do the...
There's no calculations
that
at all.
You do.
There's no calculations.
That is.
At Buffalo.
You're expected to be there and do anything that they want you to do, especially if you're an assistant coach and a low guy on staff.
If you're a GA, it's chalk. I was sleeping.
You don't have a life.
Sleeping in the office.
Yep.
My kid was at home, newborn. I was sleeping in the office.
Dang.
I'm not saying like they don't care, but it's the work that has to get done.
You have work to get done.
You have to do your work, and it's like, Coach, when you want this done, it better be done by the time I get back in the office. Well, when does he get back in the office? 5 a.m.
Ooh.
So your work got to be done, and y'all just get out the staff meeting, the defensive staff meeting at 11 p.m. Now he's coming to your desk at 11:30, 12, with his book bag on with a task list of everything you got to do. When do you need this done? Before I get back, 5 a.m.?
Yep.
I'm sleeping in the office tonight.
That coaching lifestyle, like you said, you would never coach college football. And, you know, that's the thing about it. It is a tough lifestyle to endure. It's not for everybody. Mm-hmm. It's definitely something that I hope to get back into one day. Like, my whole problem right now is I had opportunities at a junior college to get coaching jobs in college. I still haven't finished my bachelor's. And the biggest thing in coaching college is you got to have your bachelor's.
You gotta have your degree.
And I'm about a year away, probably like a year, maybe a couple months.
He's
so
grinding. He's grinding it out.
I'm still grinding. School is not for me. I got too many concussions when I played that I stopped going to school for a while. So that's another thing. Is like a lot of college coaches, people that aspire to be college coaches, don't have their degrees as well. Mm-hmm. You know, they stop because it may have gotten too hard and they just had to work and make some money.
Life hits them.
I'm lucky that I'm still able to grind, coach in high school and working. But, you know, it's awesome to see somebody in your shoes that has continued to grind. You know, you've coached at D2, D3, you're at D1 now. Mm-hmm. You know, you're at a MAC school, you're at FCS school. Like, you have hit every level that you possibly can hit in coaching in such a short period of time, and that's a credit to you because you just want to keep grinding. Yes, like, you don't want to be stagnant at one place. You want to keep growing and growing and growing until you reach where you got to be. But, you know, I'm assuming where you want to be is at the top.
Yeah, that's the thing. You know, everybody says, well, why you keep leaving? And it's always good to be great where your feet are. Like, I am going to be great at Sacred Heart, my feet are, but I always want to seek the best knowledge. I want to eventually coach the best athletes. Mm-hmm. One of the best athletes, Power 5.
Yep.
I do want to coach NFL maybe for a season or two just to get that on my resume, but ultimately, I want to be a Power 5 DC. Yep. I want to be the guy that, you know, I'm at Georgia. It's easy for me to get a commit. You know,
you ain't got really recruiting. You
exactly.
Like, you pull up with the G on your shirt. It's
the logo. It's the logo.
All the recruiting.
What time it is, boy?
All the recruiting is, and recruiting. You know, let's dive into recruiting real quick because in coaching, I don't think people understand. You can get a job higher if you are a great recruiter, right? There's guys that are at the Power 5 level right now that may not be able to like go on a board and write up a bunch of like X's and O's stuff. But damn, they can go sit in a room with their kid and his parents and say, and convince you to go there.
That's very true.
And you can get a job.
Wow.
Yeah. You can get a job that's for just true. Being a very, very good recruiter.
And that's I ain't going to lie. I mean, my coach at Buffalo, shout out to Coach Old John, used to say, you don't want to be labeled as a recruiter. And I looked at him and I was like, yes, I do. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, I do want to be the best corners coach in the country. But my ultimate goal is to be a recruiting coordinator and bring in the top dogs like my guy, Coach Dye, at Georgia last year, he had 6 commits, and it was all 6 5-stars. Like, he was the recruiter of the year. Mm-hmm. He's at Miami. But things like that nature, yes, they give you jobs because it makes your life – it makes each coach's life easier when you're coaching a 5-star commit. Like, they're already – should be naturally polished.
Right, you just – little tweaks that you
little
do.
Tweaks like so you're bringing in the dogs. It makes it easier for you to coach. So you can be. I mean, obviously, I want to be good in both aspects, but you have to be great at something. I would be a great recruiter, great on the board and whatever. But at the end of the day, if I'm bringing in the dogs and I got 4 star corners, my job's easier. So maybe I don't necessarily have to be an expert on the board and get all technical because they understand. You know what I mean? Especially if you get somebody from a program that's prep, Bosco. They're already savvy to what's going on because
they know how to watch film and film,
do everything.
It's not always about the X's and O's. It's about the Jimmys and Joes.
It's about the people you get in the building.
Mm-hmm. You ain't never heard that one before, did you?
But why Jimmy and Joe?
I don't know. It's just a saying. I ain't make it up. I just heard it.
Heard
it.
Why
you never heard that before?
Why not like Malachi and Malik?
Brandon
and Miles?
It's not always about the X's. Jimmys and Joes rhyme with X and O. So it's not always about the X's and O's. It's about the Miles and the Brandons.
I like it.
I like it too. We should change the saying right now. Like you just see.
All
right,
so let's make our own saying.
Okay.
And so it's not about the X's and the O's. It's about the. You guys make it. You guys have the problem with
it. We'll come up with.
We'll work on it.
Yeah, you guys work on it. Again, don't shoot the messenger. I'm just a guy. I'm just a guy.
Amen.
Right. I'm just a guy. Let us know in the comments what you think that we should have. You know, it's not always about the X's and the O's. It's about the blank. In the blank. Let us know. How about that?
Some crazy answers.
Some crazy answers.
Yeah.
You know, another thing with coaching, right, is networking. Having a network to someone to call just to say, hey, you know, I'm having trouble with this or, you know, what, hey, you know, a drill I can do to work on press man, you know, a drill I can work on cover two. So, like, talk about your network and coaching. Like, is it big? Is it small? Is it, I mean, I would assume it's still growing as you grow as a coach, but kind of dive deep into, like, who is your network and, like, where did it start and how's it going?
Well, the network is, I'm a communication major, communications major at West Virginia. Okay. So,
yes, sir.
You know, when you go to school, you be like, well, what's the easiest major? Communications. All right, so I'm a communication major, so I know to talk to anybody, melting pot. So my Rolodex, I'm not going to lie, for a young coach is pretty nice. You know, I'm not going to name any name, like, you know, but some big name guys that I can
that get, you could call right now.
I can call right now that I can get on the phone
you
with.
You want to name
that?
No names?
Give us one.
And don't say Savon because that'd be too easy.
Savon's light. Like, Savon's light.
Light cheese.
That's bro.
Coke butter bro. Chicken.
That's family.
Marcus Freeman. I had Coach Notre Dame.
Yep.
Jim Caldwell, the legendary head
coach. Yep. That's we had Brandon Copeland on yesterday, and he was talking about Jim Caldwell.
Yeah, so, like, it's those type of guys that, you know, are mentors, and I can call, and they can help, and, you know, just as you go along, like Al Washington, the line coach of Notre Dame.
Yep.
You know, this is some people who you meet along the way, and they like the way you vibe, they like the way you grind, but my personal Rolodex, and my personal network, I got two. I got Uplift. And Uplift, I really can't talk about it because it's more like a closer thing. And
gotcha.
It's a lot of us in there, but we all are expanding and trying to be the best coaches we can be. Then I just created my own group with me, Nigel Madison. He's the linebackers analyst at Oregon. Your boy Kyle Wiggs, he's at Frostburg State, safeties coach. And my boy Keelan Brookins, he's the corners coach at Kent State. We came up with a group because we're all best friends. We came up with a group called the Next Step Group. And we're trying to promote that to be, we're trying to be the mentors of younger coaches.
Okay.
And some guys didn't have like a big bro or a mentor that I can go to and be like, how do I get through this? How do I draw this man?
Needs that one person you can go to.
Exactly. And we're trying to be that sort.
Being the first person doing something.
That's what I'm saying. I'm going through, I'm like, how do I draw this?
I don't have a big network. So I don't, like, you know, if I'm coaching high school, the people that I'm calling is like, I got a good friend in Long Island who coaches high school. That I met through my junior college, but like to have guys at the upper level, I don't really have that.
You got me now.
I got you now, 100%. I got Savon if I want to call Savon, but you know mine's small, and I'm still looking to grow it. But just to hear you keep growing yours is an inspiration.
Nah, for sure. But sometimes you want to keep it small because sometimes you might have snakes. But that's why 100%. In our group, the way you get in, you got to FaceTime us. It's us four. You got to FaceTime us, and we just got to vibe. Like, if you're a vibe with us, and then you are what we exemplify, like, either you could be the mentor or the mentor. Like, we just added my guy, A.J. Hampton, from Virginia Tech. He's a GA, but his knowledge is great. You know, he's at Florida State and Virginia Tech. He's his own position coach. He can kick it to the next guy that we got in there, a younger guy, and he could call up on us. We could do interviews, mock interviews, just get him right. We're trying to get it to the point where, like how you said, is there an association that helps? We're trying to be the help for younger guys. Like, oh, you need help to pay for the convention.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, the big bros got you. Oh, you need help for a flight.
That's tough.
The big bros got you. You want to go do professional development with the Cowboys? Let us call somebody. You know, we're trying to be that segue. So you don't have to go look for nowhere. You don't have to like be like, yo, what's next? Or you be at the convention and you don't have no one.
You
to talk
know
to.
Nothing. Yeah. You don't know nothing about it. You just there. Big guy like that.
That's me. I walk around the convention. I'm usually by myself. I'll see, like, my college coach and some of the guys that I play with or at Kane that are coaching. I'll see Wiggs and stuff like that. Sometimes I've seen Savon down there. But, you know, that's me walking around like, hey, just going in, taking notes, just kind of keeping to myself. Not that I'm a people person. I can have a conversation with anybody. But, you know, when you go down to the AFCA convention, wherever it's at, you know, that could be, like, a big thing for a lot of people. There's thousands and thousands of coaches and thousands of egos, and you see people like, oh, I want to dap them up, and then you go up to somebody, and then they give you an attitude for coming up to them.
Yeah.
So it's like you need to know people in order to kind of make it up in this profession.
You do, and then, like, my first job from the, like, I got my job at Susquehanna through email, whatever, but when I went to the convention with Susquehanna, my first job I got, I mean, Western State was at a convention.
Mm.
You know what I mean? So you do got to take it seriously, but I didn't even know what I was doing at the convention. I just knew I used my football, like, me playing in college and high school and me seeing all my old coaches at the convention. That's how I maneuvered through it because I'm like, I don't know these other coaches, but I know who coached me.
Yeah. Right.
So I was like, I'm going to go hang out with them and save on and things like that. But now
when I go, I have a calculated plan because I talk to the OGs. I know what to do. I know who to go talk to. I don't got to go sit in on a high school. No offense. I don't have to go sit in on a high school talk about Power Reed. Yeah. I'm going to sit in the lobby and go talk to Coach Gibby, my old DC.
College coaches do not go into – they go to the convention to network. They don't go into the convention to learn some X's and O's stuff.
I learned this from the last year's conventions in Uplift that we talked about this. Everybody should go and – let's say you go with a group of five, like me. Let's say us three went. You introduce me to 10 people that I don't know. I introduce you to 10 people you don't know. You introduce me to 10 people you don't know.
That's a network right there.
Yeah, absolutely.
Damn.
And y'all just grew your network by 30 people.
And every day we're gonna do that with a different group of people. So it's gonna be us three for the first day. It's gonna be you somebody different for the next days. So you're by the end of day three, you met 50, 60 new, 70 new people, and they're on your phone.
The plan is there.
Yeah, but who would have knew that if somebody didn't tell us that, if we didn't 100%. Have the group. So that's what we're trying to do with the next up group, be that mentor, but have it open and honestly grow it to be like, as you said, we're trying to have some sponsorships. I'm going to LLC it. We're going to go with this thing because there are coaches that need help and
absolutely need toolage.
There's so many young coaches getting out the game because, you know, like you said, there's somebody's big time in them.
Or they don't know the next step. They don't know what to do. Like, they just making $7,000 for 3 years straight and I can't do this.
Right.
Because they can't
hire a quality coach.
Quality coaches just don't know the next step where to take it.
That's awesome.
That's tough. So during that time when you're down there, is there a certain time where early on in your career that you were like kind of like nervous or like did the nerves kick in for like those young coaches that are going to these conventions? Like, how did you overcome that nervousness of, okay, I'm going to go shake this dude's hand. I'm going to go up to him. Like, was there like a pep talk that you had to do? What did you do to get yourself ready for those conversations?
The first year, like my first ever year,
I was
more eager than nervous because, you know, like I said, I'm a communication major. People knew me more than I knew them because they recruited me.
Gotcha.
Like, you got to think about if you was a coach.
Yeah.
You're like, yo, that's my, like, I recruited him out of high school.
Absolutely.
Like,
yep.
So it was more of that. Like, people come up to me like, you're coaching now? I'm like, oh, you remember me? So it was like more of that moment. But when I first got down there, it was even hard for me to go shake Coach Gibby hand at NC State. He was my DC at West Virginia. He was standing around Rich Rodriguez.
Yeah.
You standing around so many people. I'm just like, you know what, I'm just going to go do it. Like, you know, I'm just going to be.
That's
but
it.
After you get that, them jitters out, it's like, I could do this with anybody. Like,
anybody.
Like, we're all people. Like, I'm going to be a DC when I get older. You know, exactly. I'm going to be Coach Gibby and somebody going to be scared to walk up on me.
Right.
So I'm like, I'm taller than this man. I'm going to walk up on me. This guy is crazy. But for the young coaches, just do it. You know what I mean? Like, just go and be personable. And if you're trying to get into coaching, the convention is free. It's not like you got to pay anything. You know the convention's in Charlotte from the 8th to the 10th of January. Fly down there to Charlotte. You want to go to Keeks and Caicos, and you want to go to Miami and party. Go better yourself and go get some information and meet people.
Absolutely. And I know there's at the convention every year, there's a young coaches or new coaches like,
Forum,
right? And I don't know if it was my first or second year, but PJ Fleck was talking in it. And like sitting there, he motivated you. Like he motivated me just sitting there. And one of the things he said is you can't be afraid to go up and give your business card and shake somebody's hand. So as soon as that talk was over, I waited in the line of like 50 people just to hand him my business card and shake his hand.
Yep.
But I had to do that because I just needed to put my face to him, right? Because, you know, he's doing great things at Minnesota, and, you know, who knows what happens in the future. But if you just shake somebody's hand, whether they keep your business card or not, at least you now subconsciously you put your face in front of them.
Oh, that and that's really all it's about. Like,
yep.
People come up to me, I met you at the convention, and sometimes I don't even remember.
You don't remember because you meet so many people.
So many people, like, I met you at the convention. I'm like, you got to play along. Like, yeah, I remember, but, like, yo, I met so many people. I don't even know who this is.
But you made an impression on them for them to remember you.
Yeah, and especially, like, we did a DB Twitter space the other day. One of the guys in the next up group has an interview through the Twitter space because he presented himself well. And that's the same thing at convention. As you present yourself well, someone's going to hear you talk, your vernacular, how you carry yourself, your swag, because it's all about recruiting and you want to be relatable.
Yep.
So as you do those things, they're like, yo, this dude's dope. I want to hire him. So the convention definitely gets you jobs. That's
absolutely
why. I ain't gonna lie, I'm not going to no talks. I'm going there to network.
That's it.
Shim sham, go get some dinner, you know. And then
you try and get the big dogs to buy dinner too. You gotta latch on to them big dogs with the cards.
Man.
They be having the school cards like, oh yeah, come on, I got you.
That's me this year.
I'm going to dinner with him.
Pay for this.
Good.
Eat it good tonight.
For sure.
So being a college coach, what has it taught you in your life outside of coaching, like the patience, or has it taught you like
discipline?
Like what in a whole has it taught you in your journey so far?
It taught me both of those things, actually, because my wife says, yo, I'm not your player. You know what I'm saying? Like, I get home and I'm like, yo, you have to be conscientious of what you're doing. Like, and she looking at me like, yo, I'm not your player. But it's crazy because I'm a coach all 24/7.
You live it.
I live it. Even when I'm at home, I'm talking to my son and he's the one. He don't understand what I'm saying. But you gotta
be patient. You can't get aggravated. He looking at me like, dad, like, you know what I'm saying? My wife's like, you got to stop doing that. But it's hard to get out of that mentality of coaching, because coaching is mentoring. And I'm not supposed to mentor my wife. I'm supposed to mentor my son, my stepdaughter. So all my words where I say, I sound like a coach, which is it's a not, but it's not. Like I said, she gets frustrated with it. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, when they get older, like my stepdaughter understands now. She's 7. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So when I talk to her and be like, you got to do certain things like this. And you got to think about it this way. And I give her analogies that I give my players. She understands it because she's older.
Yeah.
My son don't, but he
like, he will though.
Yeah, he's like, well, you know what I'm saying? But at the end of the day, I think it's a unique thing that all coaches do. Like, you got Savon. I hear him talk to his son. It's the same thing. Like, we can't snap out of it.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, it's actually pretty cool, because you're growing your son or your wife's mind. Because sometimes she looks at me like, that's actually pretty good, like smart.
The way you think about
life. The way I think about life, you got to think about life different, because you have to give tools to younger kids and think how they're thinking in their head.
Sometimes you got to manipulate their brain to, in a way, like, they might not get it this way, but how can I put it in their terms?
Exactly. So that's how I'm thinking about a 7-year-old stepdaughter or a 1-year-old. I'm like, my wife sometimes be yelling at Francie. I'm just thinking, like, maybe, like, she thinks this way and we have to explain it to her this way. And then when we do it, she be like, I understand.
Yeah.
And then my wife look at me and be like, and I, you know, see, I told you. let me handle it. You're good. I got this.
It's a coach's job to figure out a way to get through to your players or your kids or anybody. You know, like, you're a mentor in life, on and off the field, because, you know, your players, whether it's your position room of 12 guys or if it's the whole defense of 40 or if it's the whole team of 100, you know, there's always going to be somebody looking for some type of advice or some type of mentorship, whether you even know it or not.
Always.
He's living his best life right now. He loves when
I'm so hyped coaching, right now.
When he gets to talk about coaching, like, it's bad. Like, when I was going through combine prep and we were going through COVID, I had got the playbook. I'm like, yo, I got the playbook. He's like, where?
We're in my backyard on my whiteboard. I'm like, just like going over. I need you explain to me how they said it in Ole Miss, and I'm explaining to you how this looks for me, and then we're just gonna keep going.
It was fun. Yeah, you know, being able to, you know, learn the playbook with your boy.
That's what I'm saying. That's lit.
He's able to see an NFL playbook and
opened my mind up to a lot.
Coach Snow, our defensive coordinator, is a mastermind. Like, people come on our team now and are like, how do you guys run so many defenses? I'm like, it's the same defenses. We're just throwing different fronts, different DBs on the field. If we go 3 DBs, it's the same call. We're just playing it a little bit different. Mm-hmm. So, like, being a coach is, I would love to do it. It's just the off season for college coaches. I need that.
There's really no off season for college coaches. It's a full time job. I think about it as a full time job.
I ain't gonna lie to you though. You can make it what you make it. Like if you coach at Miami, and your recruiting area is Miami.
Oh, I'm outside.
You know what I'm saying? It's like your day. You recruiting Cali. Your day is done at 4 or 5, or 3, and then you might have to go see a workout at 6 from 6 to 6:30. But what do you?
You're just going to high schools.
You're just going to high schools for a week. You're on the road for 3 weeks in Cali, Miami, Texas. Like, it's actually dope. You're away from your family, which sucks. But at the end of the day, you make experience out of it. Like, you might see a coach on the road and be like, yo, what's good? Let's go get something to eat. Let's go to the bar. Let's go do this. It's all on the school.
I got a question for you. With this new NIL deal, how do you feel about it? Being a college coach and all the people paying people before college and all that stuff, how do you feel about it?
How does it affect everything?
I think it takes recruiting out of the game. If you think about it, if I can go buy a kid, especially if it's an inner city kid, oh yeah, I got Oregon, this, or whatever, Alabama, but let's say Louisville has a bag. Louisville going to throw me $4 million. I'm going to Louisville.
100%.
Like, I'm going to Louisville. Like, I'm not even thinking about, like, what this coach said to me. I don't even think if I'm going to play. I don't care if I don't play. Mm-hmm. I got $4 million.
You know what I'm saying? Like, it's no recruiting.
That's helping my family. Like, we ain't talking about football right now. We talking about life.
This is money that can change lives.
This is money that can change legacies. Like, generations. Generational wealth. So, you think about it. Like, if you was come out and let's say Ole Miss wasn't giving you an NIL deal.
Right.
And Seton Hall. Like, or whoever, like, what, St. Peter's College.
Go get that bell!
Oh, yeah. We're not going to the SEC, but like, I'm going to the Peacocks.
Yeah.
I don't care about none of this.
Yeah.
Like, I think it takes the recruiting and the, because recruiting is an art.
Right.
Like, I break down recruiting in three different areas, you know. My fault. Damn, I forgot my areas.
Your three different areas?
My three different areas. I forgot. Identification, evaluation, and development.
I
just drove 2 hours up here, so you know I'm kind of frosty. You got to identify your talent.
We appreciate you driving.
No problem. I just need my gas money. But
yeah, we talked to the bank.
But I identify the talent and evaluate and how I'm going to develop them over the 4 years. It's really simple, but I don't got to do none of that. If I'm at Miami, I'm going to identify, okay, he's a five-star.
I'm going to identify this pocket.
I'm going to identify how much we want, okay, evaluation of this pocket, and we want to develop him. I'm not even going to be here after I get him.
Right.
That's how college works. Oh, if I get this five-star, I'm off to Bama. And it's not about thinking about your next job, but why wouldn't Bama or somebody want the next best recruiter to get the best kids there?
Right. Mm-hmm. And they'll find, like, schools like that, they find a place for a good recruiter. Like, you might not even be a coach. You're like, we'll give you $2 million just to go recruit or something. Find a way to get you on the road with
analysts,
a coach.
Analysts, GAs, like, yep. GAs on the road recruiting if you good like that. Analysts go on the road recruiting if you good like that. If you're good, they're going to put you on the road and go get the kids to get in. And that gets you jobs, like you said earlier. Like, it's not about what you know, it's about who you know. And if you can recruit, if your coach will pick up the phone for you and be like, yo, this dude is a dog recruiter, you should get him, you're going to get a job 9 times out of 10. Even if you fart on the, you are a fart on the board. You can't talk ball at all.
Right.
But if you can get them kids in, you can relate.
Any change job the game. Yeah.
I think the NIL deal is going to change eventually, too, where you can't pay someone before they get into college. Because that's what it is right now. They're basically doing exactly what they were doing behind closed doors, out in the open.
Yeah, like,
he's making millions of dollars a senior.
They're making more money than I am in the league. Like, people think when you get in the league, like, instant millionaire.
Some of these kids.
Boy, I wish if I had $1 million, boy, I'd have did crazy stuff by now. You know what I'm saying? But what's the quarterback for Bama right now?
Bryce Young.
What is he making, like $2 million a year? I would stay in college 4 years. Like, I'm not about to chance it, go to the league and not make it.
I'll stay in college for 4 years and then I'll go be a coach. Like, I got six, I got, well, that's 2 times 4. Wow. $8 million.
That's why he's a coach.
I got the $8 million in the bank. I'm not about to go bang my body up. I'll have fun in college. I might come back for my red shirt. Yeah, get
right. Let me get another five.
Give me five. I'll come back for the last year, and I'm going to retire. Like, I'm going to be 23 years old coach, and I got bank.
Right.
I'm chilling. I don't care about none of this. But, like, dude, what is crazy about it is, but it does pay leverage to the players as well.
Yes.
I ain't going to say no names, no school. A player entered the transfer portal. Got some offers, some big offers. The school told him we'll get you an NIL deal to get you back. They gave him the NIL deal. He came back for that semester.
Mm-hmm.
They paid him out his bread. Once he got his bread paid, he hit the portal.
He ain't dipped on him.
Wow.
Dipped on him.
But that's how unregulated the NIL stuff.
What you gonna say
to me?
I came back. I got my bread. I'm gone. Like,
I did exactly what you asked me to do. You ain't tell me to stay. You said come back. I came back. I got my money. I left.
Left.
Cause Poo, you know I'm really shiesty.
And then he went to the school that the running backs coach left to. Like, it's crazy. Like, that's how it works. That's how it works. Like, if I'm not gonna say I'm just saying it works like that. Like, if I were to leave and I'm like, yo, this play over here is good, I'm gonna grab him with me. Like,
we
come,
we out.
Going to a bigger school. Like, you know, that's how it works in the game. It's crazy.
The game is very, like you said, shiesty. It is. You know, it is not always fair. But it is wild. It's like sometimes it could be the Wild West.
Yeah.
Could be the Wild, Wild West.
Yeah.
That's if I was in college and I had an NIL deal, well, I would have What?
If I had, oh my, my whole body would be tatted. You know, but college kids, you know, that's how you think. Like, oh, I'm gonna get tatted. Cars, sneak, my J's gonna be J's crazy. J's would have
been crazy.
But real, y'all wanna go out the club? I got you. Bars, got the ace of spades. But realistically, what they should be doing is, I got $2 million, I got $2 million, I'm gonna put $1 million in investments. I wanna
build a house from the ground.
If I was talking to my wife, I was like, if I had an NIL deal versus $5 million or whatever dollars, I'm building properties around campus. So it could be campus living as residual income I'm getting every year. I'm building a complex.
Look at dropping gems, man. For those college kids that are making bread, save your bread, invest it.
Chicken.
Do right with your chicken.
Yeah,
like, that chicken don't last forever.
Mm-hmm.
Man, especially
go to make it $7,500 a month. Well, not even a month.
A year. 12 months.
That's on tough.
So staying on the topic of players, you know, having that player-coach relationship is huge because, you know, these kids, you know, they're committing to the school, but at the same time, a lot of times they're committing to the coach because they have to stay with that coach for what a lot of times they think is 4 years. So that player-coach relationship is huge. Like, what is something that you love to do with your players, like, off the field, right? Because you have to have that relationship on and off the field. And as it's football and it's life, exactly. So what's some things that you like doing with the players off the field?
I ain't going to lie. So Sacred Heart, I just got here in March, so we haven't really – like, tomorrow we're going to the beach and getting a beach workout, but still a workout. Like, we're going to work.
Mm-hmm.
But I usually have players over. My wife cooks, have the players over. Because, you know, it's usually sometimes you don't eat at night. Sometimes you're struggling with bread. So at Midwestern State, the players came over about 3 times a week after work, and my wife would cook, have photo shoots for them. You know, that's cool. Like, so we have a photographer come out, we go on the field, do a workout, get work in. But now you got a video, and you got to have something to promote.
Mm-hmm.
But it's usually just playing PS5, you know, kicking on them in 2K. You know, just normal things that because I'm 28. A red shirt is senior is probably like 20, if he stayed a while, 23, 22, now 24 because of COVID, pushed things back. I got guys 4 years younger than me looking up to me as like big bro mentor and coach. You know what I mean? Yeah. So I'm never going to change who I am. I'm always going to be myself and be charismatic and be that guy that you can come to. I'm not going to be a stiff.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, when I go into schools and recruit, they look at me like, I went to North County in Maryland, and the coach came up. He walked past me at first, and he walked back, and he looked at me. He was like, "Are you Coach Napoleon?" I'm like, "Yeah." But I had on some like nice coaches sweats, but it looked nice.
Yep.
I had on a nice cigar hoodie. And I had some J's. And he was like, "You're a coach?" I'm like, "Yeah."
Yeah.
You know what I mean, but then when we started talking, he was like, "Oh, you're tough." Like, you know what I mean? Because I'm personable. I'm not gonna be a stiff, but I also know how to switch it up. If I go in the inner city, I'm gonna wear J's and look cool. If I go if I'm going to Seton Hall Prep,
you're gonna wear a nice little collared shirt, some tan slacks.
Some situations you have to put it on sometimes.
You have to adapt to the environments that you recruit in because you want those kids to feel comfortable coming to play for you.
Mm-hmm. And then you want your kids, like, so I, you know, feed my kids, whatever. You want your players now to tell the players that you're trying to get, like, yo, Coach Knapp's
the GOAT.
The guy. Mm-hmm. He's the guy, like, you want to play for Coach Knapp.
He is him.
Like, I had a kid on campus yesterday, and all my players that met the kid was like, yo, Coach Knapp. And it was genuine, like, yo, Coach Knapp is him. Like,
so is Coach Knapp the name that you go by on the team?
I don't go by anything. Like, just Coach in front of it. Coach Brandon, Coach Knapp, Coach E, Coach N. Just, you know,
as long as
keep the respect, you know what I mean? Like, I don't want
to. You ever had to correct the kid, like, yo, chill out?
Oh, yeah. I had to rip a kid's Canadian goose. You know how much that costs.
Woo!
Picked him up at the funeral. But now, I guess, like that, you know, you got to get, you know, because, like I said, when I started coaching, I was 25.
Mm-hmm.
So now those seniors are what, 22, 23?
Yeah.
So they try you a little bit. You got to get, you know, a little bit snappy.
Yeah, of course.
And, you know, you earn your respect.
I ain't gonna lie, I used to try. I used to try RGA. I'm like, no, because RGAs would, like, one of our GAs played with us and then became a GA.
Okay. And then tried to get that persona of like, I'm the, come on, bro.
I was slamming you a year ago. Don't try me like that. But now we good. My dude Jared, you know what I'm saying? Shouts out to you, Jared. But
he
was in the equipment staff and then played football for like a semester. But you know, like with the when you're playing college football, you gotta have the certain amount of classes that you took by a certain year and stuff like that. So you end up just going to be a GA. Then he got that tough one. I was like,
That's what I'm saying. you gotta know when to be tough, when to not be. Like, mm-hmm. people can see through that. Like, people see my Twitter and see my gram, my TikTok. I'm young. I'll be dancing. Like, I'm cool. Mm-hmm. But I do have that switch. Like,
You see when I have fun, when it's time for business.
Oh, yeah. Like, my players know right now. I already told them. Like, they saw me in the spring. I was mad fun. Because it's springtime. We're not playing against nobody else. But as the times were getting shorter and shorter, now it's July. We on the field. I'm straight face, like, mm-hmm. I'm on you. Because now it's time to get paid. It's time to get money. So, the demeanor shortly switches. But I still got to, you know, they still want to come over for dinner. Mm-hmm. Wayne, I'll give them some donuts. You know.
Those were the times I remember more than the games. Building that bond with your teammates. Everybody sitting there, you cracking jokes. Everybody, you getting on coach getting on you. Mm-hmm. You know, you sitting there with your coach's kids, and then you see his aspirations of why he does things and why he, you know, is there, you know, 5 a.m. getting stuff done before we're there. He's telling us, he's staying up, sending us film. You see his why, his motivation and stuff like that, and see your motivation. I know your players appreciate that. And then, you know, some player teammates I played with, when we went to coach's house, like, they didn't have that at home. Mm-hmm. They didn't have a father figure who can show them how to be a father around their kids. So, like, having our coaches, when they would interact with their kids, and, you know, Matt, Coach Lou, Coach Freeze, all my head coaches at Ole Miss, they put family first. Like, family was over there. The kids were always running around. That's right. They're throwing football in practice. You know all their kids, so you know how to be a man and how to hold down the fort at home. Mm-hmm. It's like, you know, football ain't gonna last forever. Coaching ain't gonna last forever. Eventually, you're gonna be a dad. You're gonna be a husband.
Family at home.
So you got to be able to transition into, okay, how do I be this person? And absolutely. Seeing our coaches do that was big for so much.
Exactly. And that's the light that I'm trying to shine. Like, yo, I can still do my work, but I'm a family man. You can see how I am around my son. Mm-hmm. You can see, like, and also it's like, when you tell a kid, how many times your coach say, you're like my family, you like my kid. But if you go to his house and he not,
nah.
Exactly. So I treat my players the same way I treat my stepdaughter. Like,
yep.
Like, we're all gonna have fun. I'm gonna get on you. Just like,
it's time to discipline. I mean, it's time to chill.
Teach them to switch. Exactly. You gotta teach them to switch. Exactly. Now, as a young coach, being around like older coaches, and like they're not on social media. You know, they may have a Twitter, but it's just for recruiting purposes. Like, you know, me and you, we got Instagram, we got TikTok, we got Twitter. Like, and I know you just said it. You're active on all of them. I'm also active on all my social medias, and a lot of older coaches don't understand that. And they may look at it as a distraction. Like, talk about how it's not a distraction, and it's just our way of relating to the younger generation that's coming up, because TikTok is the wave. You know, doing dances on TikTok is cool. Like, it's just a way of expressing yourself, because social media is so big in today's society, and it's so looked upon in the coaching world, I feel, by older coaches in a negative light, when it really should just be a positive way.
Yeah, I think this goes back to being relatable. I mean, the old coaches don't understand. I guarantee you, behind closed doors, they're telling their GA, yo, go hit them up and do the dance with them.
Show me how to do this.
Show me how to do this.
Kid told me he wanted to do this dance. Yo, let's practice.
Mm-hmm. Literally, like, I don't even remember Cincinnati with Coach Luke Finkel, but he posted a video when TikTok first got popular, like 2 years ago, and they all was doing the gritty on the... It was all doing it, and Luke Finkel, mm-hmm. like, he's not that old, but he had all the coaches doing it, because he knows that's the recruiting tool.
Yep, absolutely.
He knows, like, a high school kids would be like, yo, that's tough. Like, look at Cincinnati doing that.
Oh, they're
like,
lit.
I got so many players or high school recruits that would send me my TikTok, like, yo, coach, you drawing like wallet. Yeah. But it's like, okay, I just got a kid to text me. Like, I'm not texting a kid. He's texting me about something that he saw on his For You page.
Mm-hmm.
All right, let's start a conversation. So it's always an icebreaker, because it's like, yo, I saw you, shaking your head. You're shaking your ears, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know what I mean?
Jersey.
You know what I'm saying? I can tell you that I see you doing that, young bull. Let me show you my stuff. And then you can do that. And now y'all have something relatable rather than being, yeah, like, oh, what's that TikTok stuff?
Yeah,
you
know, exactly.
Old coach was like, but you got to respect old coaches. But I'm telling you, the OGs, they know what's up. They don't frown upon it. They just won't do it.
Yeah.
They will tell their GA, you better be doing it. I'm telling you, because I was a GA, and it wasn't like, yo, go do these dances. Like, it was like, yo, you got to go do this, get this.
Yeah.
Done. Yo, go play the 2K with this kid. Go do this with this kid. But they weren't doing it. You know what I mean? But it's I think the game's going to change with this new rule that's about to pass, that where analysts are going to be able to be on the field coaches and go recruit. Because I think, you know, a lot of analysts now are older coaches. Like,
yeah.
I don't say old coach. I mean, like 70. So, like, you probably saw, like, there's young analysts.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then those are the computer guys. Then there's, like, you got old.
The ones that dropping gems in the back.
Yeah, like, the dudes who, you like, well, where is he at? He's not on the field. Like, you know, he in the office.
Yeah,
like,
he got to stay. He can't come on the field. And all the field. That, yeah.
Those analysts, no offense, I think they're, once they pass through the analyst and coach, I think those analysts are going to get weaned out because you're now I can use you on the field. You're kind of old. You can't be on the field. You know what I mean? Yeah. Respectfully.
They were absolutely. they were just kind of like placeholders when coaches needed like advice. To
advice. Like, yo, yeah, like.
They're like a consultant more than they are now.
Literally like, yo, what do you think about this? I know you've been in the game for mad long. They might have a different role for those type of guys, right. But the analyst titles are going to start
extra
going.
Coach. Nah, we need younger coaches.
We need younger going on the field. Yeah. You know, I might need Drew to be a consultant, but I need these two younger analysts to go on the field and coach.
Yeah, that's probably a big for the young coaches. That's going to be
huge.
Hey, don't worry about it. I'm just, you know, y'all be
social media. I think also people got to know how to use it. It's a tool. Don't make it a distraction. You can't make it a distraction. You got to use it as a tool to better yourself and to promote yourself, promote what you're doing. But once you make it a distraction, you're, you know, if you're not taking care of A, you can't let B overtake B, A. You know what I'm saying?
Yo,
that's what social media. A lot of people get caught up in like, oh, I got to do this, got to do that. But you're not taking care of what you're supposed to be taking.
Your hand.
Like, it's like some of our players, you know, that was at Buffalo, I'm going to say. Like, we have some TikTok creators, like famous TikTokers on, you know.
The blue check and everything.
Yeah, like with blue checks on TikTok. But it's like, all right, you're doing mad dances a day. All right, respectfully, you're making bread because it's your thing. But it's like, you're not making no plays on the field.
Yeah.
Now it's a problem.
Yeah, like.
Now you're giving coach a reason.
Now the coach is going to bring it up. Hey, yo, maybe if you got up in TikTok.
Every time, like, who coming to me and the coach will be like, you over there. You need. And look at this on film. Boop. And now you're on film getting bombed. And then right after you get on bomb again, right after you get yelled at, you back to doing that. It's like, I understand you making bread, but take care of your business.
Yeah. Exactly.
Then go make your bread. You over there is getting up, and I'm like, you just got ran over 5 hours ago.
Yep.
Like, you know, but.
That's huge. That's huge.
It really is true.
So look, I got two surprise questions for you. Surprise. Which one do you want? One or two?
I'll take one. You feel me? I'll take one.
All right. So, were you a Disney? Did you watch Disney back in the day?
Nah, I was straight football all day.
Man, stop the cap. I swear I didn't watch Disney.
What
did you watch? Nickelodeon?
Nickelodeon.
All right, okay. All
right, what's your top three Nickelodeon shows of all time?
SpongeBob was one.
Okay, respectfully. Respectfully. You can't go wrong.
Oh, I can't even do top Nickelodeon because I was watching Ed and A. That's Cartoon Network.
Yeah, you already said Nickelodeon. Yes. If you want to go Cartoon Network, we could change it.
I can't because it was Nickelodeon. It was Ren and Stimpy. Ren and Stimpy was Cartoon Network too, right?
I don't even know what that is,
That was
Ren and Stimpy.
That was Cartoon Network.
You don't know what Ren and Stimpy is?
Nah, he don't. He's a Disney fanatic.
Think about it.
Disney
Nickelodeon. So
Cat Dog
will be SpongeBob. Cat Dog.
Rocket Power.
Oh yeah,
hey, Arnold.
Wiggity. Rocket Power was on. Yeah.
Rocket Power.
I thought that was Cartoon Network, but it'll be
on Nickelodeon. Hey Arnold, Rocket Power for me. Stoop top kids, two, not two.
Oh, Jimmy Neutron, Fairly Odd Parents.
Not my top three. They'll be top five.
Fairly Odd Parents is the best show on Nickelodeon.
SpongeBob
ever.
Is the best.
I never watched
either. I'm not playing with, no, other than SpongeBob. SpongeBob is normal.
I didn't watch SpongeBob.
You lost your childhood. But
yeah, it wasn't something that I ever watched.
Now he's bugging.
He's bugging. if you ain't like SpongeBob, you were sitting there watching it.
Yeah,
I
watched it? Yeah. Was I religiously saying, oh, SpongeBob's on? Like, nah, no.
That joke was funny.
What was you sitting down glued to?
Disney. I was a Disney, Rocket Power. I was Nickelodeon, Disney, Hey Arnold, Rocket Power.
Rocket Power was definitely.
Sweet Life of Zack and Cody.
I don't know what that is.
What?
Whoa.
Sweet Life of
Zack and Cody. First of all, that doesn't sound like something. That's So Raven was my thing.
Okay, that's Disney. It was That's So Raven and Sweet Life of Zack and Cody. They were on at 6 and 6:30.
I probably turned it off. Like, after I saw the names, the Sweet
Life. He said, all right, time to go outside.
Yeah, like, you know, but nah, those are my three.
That's a good three.
Those are my three.
Respect
what's
three.
What's two?
Okay, and then.
Two. All right. Here we go.
2014.
I got set up for this.
2014, right? The last NCAA football game came out.
Mm-hmm. He's going to go with yours.
Denard Robinson, right?
Denard Robinson was the cover.
Who would you put on your cover from 2014 until now?
Who would be on your cover for
Instagram? You got that's a lot of
so 20.
A lot of years.
What? I don't even remember who played.
Who was a dog?
Do you, there's got to be names that pop into your head like, yo, they were dogs. I think it'd be them.
Like each year though? Like,
no, just one.
We just need one from one, all the years.
From 2014 to 2022. To who was the biggest dog
in college
that you would put on an NCAA cover if NCAA cover was to come back for 2023?
It's not going to be mine. So
who would be your dog? Like, you'd be like, he has to be on the cover. He was a trendsetter. He was that guy.
I'm
on, coach.
I was going to say Tavon Austin, but you said.
Nah,
I said Tavon Austin, but that was
too early. That was too early.
I would have to say.
That's a West Virginia thing.
It's West Virginia thing, right?
Just highlight tape of all time.
You ain't gonna like this one. I'll say Minka Fitzpatrick. Defense and prep and.
I can't get mad. Jersey.
Yeah, we can't get mad at that.
I would say Minka.
All right, bet. I like that one. Either Minka or Brill. He said Brill.
Brill in college was offense, defense,
bro.
Kick return, punt return.
Yeah.
Bro, like.
So you think Brill Minka. Jersey, guys. Jersey.
Bro, you know, we here.
Bro, Jabril in college.
Was different.
Jabril in high school, when he transferred to Paramus, it was like, I was like, this dude is crazy.
I think the best two players to ever come out of Jersey in our era, like 30 years, I don't know, back then, is Will Hill and Jabril Peppers. I don't think you know who Will Hill is.
I don't remember. Everybody talks about him.
He was the number one athlete in the country, number one safety in the country, number one player, and the number one quarterback in the country. He had him rated as all number one across the board. He went to Florida as a freshman. Freshman, won the Natty, started two picks and 50 tackles freshman year. 6'3", 215.
Different.
He was different. He was a prep guy, you know?
Pirates.
Marauders?
Marauders.
Hard. The Pirates. You talking about
some Marauders? That's on Marauders. Isn't it what is a Marauder?
The Marauder's a pirate.
So I'm not taking kill people. Wrong, but.
You kill people, right?
We gotta end it on that.
What was y'all?
Bombers, baby. You know the vibe.
We got two here.
That is terrible. That sounds
Bombers, baby. But think about it. Like, we were public. Y'all all went from a school to try to make a good school.
What do you mean try?
We came out of the trenches from a town where we couldn't have people.
Hold on, trenches. I see nice.
How many state championships you have?
Me? Well, how many do I have personally?
How many do you have personally?
Zero. Nil.
That's why. Hey, and that's the episode.
You already know the vibe.
And we got the dog. Appreciate you, dog. Driving 2 hours. Yo. And coming in to talk to us.
Hell yeah, this is dope.
For sure. I want everybody to go like, comment, subscribe, tell a friend to tell a friend.
Because we're all friends.
Tell a friend, my guy Miles. You feel me? I appreciate both of you. My guy Mike.
Mr. Dapped himself up.
Mr. Dapped, that's why I tried to do it to myself. But I don't think, no one caught that, y'all ain't.
Nah, we peep.
Okay, I gotta get that down. But I appreciate you guys for sure.
Hey. Go follow Brandon, man.
Oh, yeah, follow me on everything. Coach Napoleon, that's my name on everything.
Like that.
Off season.
All men are created equal. Some just work harder during the off season.
Work.